Well, let me welcome you to the Lansdowne History Forum for the month of October. And we're actually very honored tonight to do something special. I have a guest speaker. Normally we do not. Mike Sheehan and I will lead a panel discussion. But we have something really special tonight. We have Wendy Schmaleski, who's a Lansdowne resident, but someone who's committed herself to Lansdowne, talking on a subject that we are going to talk about throughout the year, women's rights and the role of women in obtaining those rights in American history. Wendy has her PhD from the State University of New York at Binghamton, and she leads Her Hat Was in the Ring project, the role of women in elected office in 1850 to 1920. On behalf of the Lansdowne Library, especially the History Forum, let's welcome Wendy.
I'm very glad to be here tonight, and I have to do a couple of things tonight, which is to talk to you about the history of women in elected office up through 1920 in the United States. Also, I talked to you about the Her Hat Was in the Ring project, which is a project that I founded about 8 years ago with two other colleagues, trying to track and find all the women who campaigned for public office. The earliest one we found so far, 1853, a woman who was elected to a countywide office in Lincoln County, Maine. So I'll be telling you more about her, Olive Rose, later. And also I want you to have an opportunity to look at some of the artifacts that my colleagues and I have found over the years. There's this material up here, and this goes beyond 1920 up through the present, as you can see. And then there's a display in the lobby also. I think that's going to be here through the end of the month. Sandra, the exhibit?
Until you take it out.
So there's more exhibit. There's more items in that exhibit outside, and I'm happy to talk to you about any of these items or any of the ones outside. So Her Hat Was in the Ring project, as I said, is tracking all U.S. women who campaigned for public office, many of whom were elected on the state and local levels before 1920. And there was one woman who actually was elected to Congress in 1916, and we'll talk about her, Jeanette Rankin, a little bit. My colleagues and I decided to limit the project to women who actually campaigned. And there were a couple of reasons for that. First one was there were thousands and thousands and thousands of women who volunteered, were hired, or appointed to public office in this period. So we thought we couldn't actually cover, and just two of us and then three of us trying to track all these women. The second was that we thought it was an important, significant factor for the rights of women and for the idea of what citizenship would be in the United States to only track women who went before their peers, so to speak, and before the voters. And they were then chosen, or not chosen, but at least they campaigned. So those are the factors. When my colleague and I, Jill Norgren, first started this project, we thought there'd be about 50 women. But even then, we couldn't even name all 50 women, but we thought there'd be about 50. So far, we're up to about 3,400. And we think there's at least another 2,000 that we haven't put into the project yet. So the project, Her Hat Was in the Ring, actually is a website that you can go to tonight if you want to, or whenever. And it is run with a database in the background where we enter all the information that we can find about the campaigns and races that these women ran. And it updates automatically as we enter the information. So you can see that. Not only, so there's a little entry, a biographical entry about the women, the campaigns they ran, a photograph if we found it, resources of where we found the information. And then you can also search by party, by office, and by state. And you can combine any of those to find, you know, all of the Republican women who ran in Kansas for the office of county treasurer. Believe me, there were some. There were some. And so that you can find this information. Anyway, so let's get started with the next slide. So I'm going to give you a little bit of historical background on the status of women in the United States up through this period, a little bit through the period, and then we'll talk specifically about women in office. So the slide you see here is actually an etching, an illustration, I think from, did it say Harper's Bazaar there? In the 1870s. By Howard Pyle, who was a quite well-known illustrator of the period. And this is a picture that he imagined what New Jersey looked like in the early 19th century. So a lot of people don't know, but women who had enough property could vote in New Jersey between the 1790s until 1807. And it doesn't say that this particular slide, but Pyle's caption for this was, in the good old days. Mm-hmm. So he was, I think we can imagine, he was a proponent of women regaining the right to vote. So we know that only in New Jersey did women have the right to vote. There's some evidence that African American women voted in New Jersey as well, if they had the right property requirements. I don't know if we remember, but in the United States, the qualifications for voting, who could vote, who couldn't vote, and so on, was left up to the states. So every state in the United States had its own constitution and voting rights. I'm not sure why that just skipped ahead, but we'll go back. And so New Jersey decided in the 1790s that there was a property requirement, but any resident with a property, right property, could vote. In 1807, the legislature changed that law to limit the vote to men of property over the age of 21 and who were white. So they basically eliminated any African American voters in the state and women, all at one point. Women didn't regain the right to vote in New Jersey until 1920. African Americans supposedly, with the passage of the 15th Amendment in the early 1870s. So, citizenship rights. What voting we think of as one of the rights of citizenship. There are other rights and obligations. Everyone in the United States, whether they be citizens or residents, are required to have certain obligations are required. Obeying the law, okay, everybody's required to obey the law. Pay taxes, okay, everybody, even women, were required to pay taxes if you had property and taxes. But then there are other obligations that only men had. Military service, okay, was an obligation that men had. Women were did not have that obligation. There were also rights that went along with this, and one of the rights was voting and being elected to office. As we know, in most states, in the early republic, women did not have the right to vote. And the excuses, even though the Constitution said that everybody was equal, it doesn't give anybody the right to vote. Look in the Constitution, there's no right to vote in the Constitution. There have been several Supreme Court cases over the decades about that very right. There's also no naming of gender, really, on who has the rights in the Constitution. It does say all men are created equal, but it was assumed that that word men actually meant human beings. But there's no limitation on women running for office in the Constitution. And in fact, there were a couple of women, I think about 30 actually, who ran for federal offices before 1920. As I said before, only one was elected. But there is no limitation on running for office in the Constitution. But most women in the United States came under what was a legal definition of, once they were married, as legally being subsumed by their husbands. So that it was part of English common law that the United States inherited for the most part. And there were variations on it, but for the most part, married women had no legal identity. So they couldn't go into court and testify against their husbands, because that would be testifying against yourself, because they were part of this now male legal persona. They couldn't write contracts. Women had no right to their own earnings that belonged to their husbands. Women couldn't own property in their own names. They had no legal right to the guardianship of their children. Women could not decide on their own, this is wives, where they would live. That was something that legally their husbands could decide. Women didn't even know the clothes on their backs. It was all under the sort of almost guardianship of their husbands. In addition, women had no entry into most professions. They didn't have the same educational opportunities as men did. They didn't have access to the professions, as I said, and most workplaces were closed to women. Now, it's not to say that women didn't work, they did. And some worked in the home, and some did work in jobs that were open. Women did run businesses, even if they couldn't legally own them. Widows could own them, and so could single women. But again, without a lot of economic resources, a lot of women did marry. But then they didn't gain this legal, they lost their legal persona. And this was all used as an excuse for why women couldn't vote, because they had no legal identity in the country. However, as we'll see, this was very quickly challenged. Here it was challenged in New Jersey that women, no matter what their marital status, were allowed to vote. Women who ran for office, whether or not they were married, and at least half of these women were married, we'll see, were given the opportunity to represent their local governments, and some actually went into court to represent their local governments. So indeed, there's this sort of disconnect almost between women's actual legal right under common law and how the states were actually voting women into office. If you remember earlier, I said that the states decided on who could vote, the qualifications for voters. What happened fairly quickly, not only for women but for other categories of people, is that different states started saying, well, maybe, you know, this group of people could actually vote in this kind of election. So in the 1830s, Kentucky allowed widows with children in the school district to vote for school boards. Okay. And other states started giving these sort of piecemeal rights to various groups of people, including women. Sort of, there's a whole patchwork across the country. And so we don't even know, nobody's really traced all of this yet, but at different times, in different places across the country, women had different rights. The other thing that happened too is that in some states, women were allowed to run for certain offices before women had the vote. Now this is sort of contrary to what we think of as who's qualified to be a voter, an elected official. In most places, in most times in the United States, you have to be an elector, that is a voter, to be elected to office. That wasn't necessarily true. What we find is some of the earliest women were voted into office by men. All right, let's go forward to the next slide. So just a little bit of information about the women's movement in the 19th century. We think of today as the women's movement as being the movement for suffrage, for women's voting rights, but in actuality, it was a far, far broader movement for a whole variety of rights that significantly changed over the 19th century. So this is a picture of today of Seneca Falls, of the chapel at Seneca Falls, where the first Women's Rights Convention was held in 1848. Today it's a National Historic Site. It's been rebuilt to some extent. And about 300 people met in the summer of 1848 in a small town in upstate New York in the Finger Lakes. And they drafted this call for women's rights. And you see on the right a picture of that document with some of the names of the people who signed it. Now, this was called by some people that some names you might be familiar with. Here's Elizabeth Cady Stanton. She lived in Seneca Falls at that time. Next to her are James and Lucretia Mott. They lived in Philadelphia, the Philadelphia Quakers. James was a merchant, and Lucretia was a Quaker minister, activist, abolitionist, and they had relatives in upstate New York, so they were there. Frederick Douglass, at this point he's escaped from slavery, has reinvented himself as a leader in the abolitionist movement, a newspaper editor, and supporter of women's rights. Marianne McClintock is another resident of upstate New York who was also there, and Mary Coffin Wright, Lucretia's sister. Anyway, so these are some of the people who were the leaders, the conveners of the Seneca Falls Convention. And this is a list of some of the issues that this Declaration of Sentiments, based on the U.S. Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, that they were working on. So, voting and election rights. Right to property and earnings, that is, that these are, they wanted to be able to own things and earn, keep their earnings. Marriage and divorce rights, okay? Some of these were different for men and women. Divorce was very hard to get, so if you made a mistake and got when you got married and decided this was not the thing, it was very difficult to get out of it. Equal guardianship of children. As I said, women did not have legal right to their children, and often that was used as a way for men, for husbands to control their wives. Well, if you can leave, but the kids are staying with me. And it also meant that women didn't have a right to say where their children went to school, if they were living at home, where they might, what kind of apprenticeship or jobs that they would get. That was all within the husband's and father's legal rights. Equal access to all areas of employment. The middle of the 19th century is the time when that begins to change. The 1850s, we see the opening of the Women's Medical College here in Philadelphia. That was one of the places. We'll talk about some of the other educational and professional opportunities that were opening up to women at this point in time. Let's see, access to participation and leadership in religious institutions. Starting to see some of the religious bodies opening up to women to leadership. The first women ministers, and this is outside of Quakers who did have already have women ministers, begin to open up. Very difficult, but they did. And definition of morality and sexuality to be the same for men and women. You know, you probably have an idea that women in this period, if they had any kind of sexual relations outside of marriage, they were definitely considered outside of respectability, where that wasn't always true for men. And so this was very important to them. All right, so these are moving on a little bit further into the century. These were some of the people who came into the women's movement after the 1848 convention. Susan B. Anthony, she was not at the Seneca Falls Convention, but she was a teacher and a temperance worker, that is, the temperance movement working against the consumption of alcohol. And she very quickly became very firm friends with Elizabeth Cady Stanton and other members of the women's movement and worked with them. Lucy Stone, another very active participant early on in the movement, kept her own name after she got married to Henry Blackwell. And for this, she was notorious. Sojourner Truth, born a slave in New York in the end of the 18th century, freed herself in about 1827. Slavery for adults in New York didn't end until 1828. And if you were under the age of 21 in 1828, your master had the right to keep you as a slave until you reached the age of 21. But she became very active with the women's movement and with abolitionism. Carrie Chapman Catt on the far right there, a little bit later on in the end of the 19th century, and she became president of the National American Woman Suffrage Association, which was the biggest national suffrage organization. And she was the president of the organization at the very end when the 19th Amendment was ratified in 1920, granting women universal suffrage. Alice Paul, also fairly local, born in Morristown, New Jersey, graduate of Swarthmore College, 1904, I think. She started what was called the National Woman's Party in 1916. Excuse me. She, after she graduated from Swarthmore, she went to London, where she became involved with the Women's Social and Political Union, run by the Pankhurst family, and they were militant suffragists. Those were the women that chained themselves to the gates of Parliament, threw acid on golf courses, ripped paintings. And when they were arrested by the police in England, they were force-fed, and Paul was force-fed. Basically, they put rubber tubes down their throats or through their noses because they were going on hunger strikes, declaring themselves to be political prisoners. When Paul came back to the United States, she got involved with Carrie Chapman Catt's group. The strategy at that point was, should the big suffrage organizations work on a federal amendment, or should they continue working state by state? Because the idea was that if you could get enough states to elect, to give women the vote, to elect people to Congress who would then change the federal government so that all women could vote, or should you just go straight for a federal amendment? Paul was in favor of going straight for a federal amendment. And that indeed became the strategy after about 1913, 1914 for the entire National American Woman Suffrage Association. But she had arguments with Catt and went off and founded the National Woman's Party. During World War I, the US entered the war in April of 1917. Alice Paul and members of the National Woman's Party picketed the White House. And they held up signs that said, Kaiser Wilson, Woodrow Wilson is president, when are you going to give democracy to women at home? Because this was supposed to be the war to restore democracy. For that, people, passers-by, attacked them. The police arrested the women. They came back every day for years. And once again, Paul was arrested with about 200 other women over time, and they were again force-fed in prison in the United States. All right. This is another picture a little bit earlier of the National American Woman Suffrage Association. And seated in the middle with her hair pulled back is Susan B. Anthony. This is about 10 years before she died in 1906. All right, so were these two women actually very early candidates? So the woman on the right is Lucretia Mott, as we've already seen, that she was one of the organizers of the Seneca Falls Convention. And this woman on this other side here, Maria Western Chapman, a Boston abolitionist from a well-to-do family and very active in the peace movement and in the anti-slavery movement. In 1837, Chapman's name appeared as a write-in candidate for governor on ballots in Massachusetts. it was, I don't think she ever knew anything about it. I think it was a satirical write-in, people trying to make fun of the anti-slavery movement. In 1848, the first convention of the Liberty Party, which eventually morphed into the Republican Party, on a voice vote, Mott's name came up as a candidate for vice president. And again, I don't think she knew anything about it. This was not something that she would have saw. But there they were. They're not in the database because we don't really think that they campaigned. All right, so here's the first woman that we found so far, Olive Rose, Lincoln County, Maine, was elected in 1843 to serve as County Register of Deeds. So this was an office, a county-wide office, and she would have been in charge in making sure that documents about property transfer and so on were accurately recorded, because this was important, in especially in a rural area, to know who owned what. So this was an important position. And she served in the office for about 4 to 6 years, not quite sure. And so women couldn't vote in Maine, but men voted her into office. And the little newspaper article that you see there in the corner says something about how the people of Maine are obviously in favor of female rights and emancipation. Okay. So we found a few other women who were elected to office. There are a couple of women in a school board in Massachusetts who were elected in the 1850s, a couple of school boards in Ohio. And then the next we see are really into the 1860s. So here are three women who ran for federal office in the 1860s and 1870s. Now, there's nowhere until 1869 that women actually have the right to vote, so let's remember that part. But these women are running for federal office, which there's no limitation. So Elizabeth Cady Stanton, who we've already met, ran for US Congress from Brooklyn in 1867. Okay. Didn't get very far, but she did run. I'm not sure she had a party. I don't think she did. She was affiliated with any particular party. The next woman was Victoria Woodhull, who announced her candidacy for president, US president, 1871, for the election in 1872. Unfortunately, by the time of the election, she was in jail. So Victoria Woodhull is kind of notorious. In the newspapers at the time, she was depicted as Mrs. Satan, with black wings and looking like a demon. And partially it's because she believed in free love, that is, that women and men should have the right to marry or be involved romantically and sexually with anyone they wish to, that divorce should be available. But she also believed in free education, public education, the 8-hour work day, and a few other things that have actually come to pass. She was also a spiritualist, and she and her sister, Tennessee Claflin, were stockbrokers in New York. And they used the voices of the spirits to advise Cornelius Vanderbilt on his investment, rather successfully, I think. And there were lots of rumors that Tenny was actually Vanderbilt's mistress as well. Anyway, during the 1870s was the rise of moral reform with the Comstock laws. I don't know if you've covered Anthony Comstock previously, but he was very much interested, of course he had lots of political backers, in trying to limit what he thought of as licentious literature going through the mails. And so they managed to pass laws limiting the distribution of information about sexuality and birth control and divorce and so on through the US mails. And what they, he went after Victoria Woodhull and found that some of the things that she was mailing to supporters was actually licentious material. And indeed, there's a pamphlet at the end of the table there, one of those quotes about sexual slavery. Okay. All right, Belva Lockwood, also very interesting person. She ran for president twice. 1884 and 1888 on the Equal Rights Party, and in 1884 she had a woman vice president, Marietta Stowe, and in 1888 I think Alfred E. Love, who was a Philadelphia Quaker and head of the Universal Peace Union. Lockwood was a lawyer. She had gone to law school in Washington, D.C., one of the first, though not the first, women lawyers. The school didn't want to grant her a degree, even though she had passed all of her exams and so on. And she finally convinced President Ulysses S. Grant to use his influence to get her her degree. In 1879, she became the first woman lawyer to practice before the Supreme Court. Lockwood went on to represent the Eastern Cherokee in their suit against the United States, and the winning suit, actually, had gone on for years. And so she was the lawyer who eventually represented them in their winning suit, I think 1904, 1906, something like that. She was also very much of a peace activist. And there's a couple things on the tables about Lockwood. All right, so here's the first woman actually elected, Jeanette Rankin. She was elected in Montana to serve in Congress, and she served one term from 1917 to 1919, and then she served again in the early 1940s. So Rankin had gone to work for the National American Woman Suffrage Association as a campaigner. So she led the campaign, I think, in Washington State to get suffrage in the state. That was an unsuccessful campaign, one of many. But she went back to her home state of Montana and led the campaign there, and it was successful. So she was a Republican, but Montana, because of its, you know, it's a very widespread population with small numbers of people and widespread across a large geographical area, she was an at-large candidate, and that meant there were no congressional districts. But everybody in the state could vote for the congressional representatives. So she was able to build a coalition of women who could now vote, labor, miners, and other rural populations, farmers. And so she was elected. And there was a huge uproar. What is she going to do? Is she going to cry when she comes into Congress? What is she going to do? How are we going to have a woman in Congress? But there she was, elected legally from the state of Montana. Soon after Rankin arrived in Washington, D.C., Congress was faced with whether or not to vote for the entry of the U.S. into World War I. And she was one of about 54 congressional representatives who voted against the war. And during the call for votes on the floor of the House, they were only supposed to say yay or nay. And when it came to Rankin, it was like a silence. What, here's this only woman. And she got up and said, "I love my country, but I cannot vote for war." And she knew, her brother, who's her campaign advisor, knew that she was not going to run. She could not be elected to a second term because of that vote. And of course, the women's suffrage organizations were like, no, here's the only woman we know that she's not going to be reelected because of this vote. All right. So, in the other women that we found. So here's one of the first Jewish women that we found who ran for office. Hannah Solomon was never actually elected, but she ran twice She lived in Chicago. She was very much of an activist in her community, civil affairs and so on. She was also the founder of the National Council of Jewish Women. And she ran for university regent. It was the only statewide office open to women in Illinois. In 1904, women didn't have any kind of vote in the state, and besides local educational offices, but also region. Now, the university regent, which sounds like a small position, but it was very important in the state. And it meant that the regents decided on how educational monies at the university level was spent, who would be hired, the direction of education, whether they would include technical training or not, and who could actually get into the university. And one of the earlier candidates, a woman who actually was elected, Lucy Flowers, in mid-1890s, had actually made coalitions between growing African American political organizations to form a coalition. And so they helped her get her elected because they knew, you owe us, we owe you, you can vote in favor of allowing African Americans into the state university system. Education, still in the United States, is one of the ways that people can raise their status. You know, if you get a high school education and then a university education by this point, you know, it's almost guaranteed, certainly by this point, that you would get a good job. I mean, I know it may not necessarily be true any longer, but at this point, even a high school education was almost a guarantee to success, and certainly a university education was far more acceptable. Okay. And as a piece of one of her campaign flyers on the table. All right, so here we've only found two African-American women who are actually campaigning for office. I'm not saying there are only two African-American women, just those are the only two we've found so far. Now, there were lots of African-American women, and of course Jewish women and other ethnicities as well, who were appointed or served in various offices. But these are the two that we found who actually ran for office. So the first one is a woman named Anna Woodby. Again, ran for university regent in Nebraska, where she was the president of the Women's Christian Temperance Union. The Women's Christian Temperance Union was indeed what it sounds like, which was a group of women, mostly Christian, as it seems, who were against the consumption of alcohol. And this is a really important political group in the last quarter of the 19th century. Almost every woman who was any kind of public figure in any way was a member of the WCTU. And the WCTU began as a grassroots movement. If you remember, that most women don't have control over family resources in any way, shape, or form. So if a husband drank all of his wages, a woman could do nothing about that, except by moral persuasion. That she could ask him not to do that. But she had no legal recourse. She didn't own half the resources in the house. She couldn't take the children and move elsewhere. So this organization started to help women kind of destroy the source of what they saw as a very dangerous substance. Was alcohol. By this point in time, by the 1890s, the WCTU is very active in the suffrage movement. The WCTU, their national policy is supporting suffrage. Because if you can get women into being able to vote, then they can vote against the liquor interests. And the liquor companies spend a lot of money trying to persuade voters, not male voters, not to vote for women's suffrage because they were afraid that women would vote them out of existence or at least increase their profits. All right, so the second woman that we found, Grace Campbell, ran for state house in New York in 1920. New York passed women's suffrage in 1918, so they were a little bit of ahead of the national federal amendment. And immediately, women ran for office. Campbell ran from, 19th District, which was in Harlem. She was a socialist. She did not win either of these races, but she did try. And I should say a lot of women in third parties, like socialists, were had a very hard time getting elected. So here's a woman from Boston named Julia Duff. And she was an Irish-American woman, an important ethnicity in the shifting powers in Boston. And she was actually elected to the Boston School Board. Women did have school suffrage in Massachusetts from the 1880s onward. Women could vote. And there were separate women's ballots. I don't think I brought one of those. I think there's one out in the case. You'll see there were separate women's ballots because there were only certain offices that women could vote for. But she brought out a lot of Irish-American women voters. And for the first time, because here was their candidate. You know, again, school boards were important community resources for people who either didn't have enough education, wanted their children to have more education, and who decided where the resources would go in a very large city. Women were actually, the Massachusetts legislature in the mid-1870s had opened up the Boston School Committee to women for the first time. They couldn't vote, but they allowed women to be elected to the school committee. So this was certainly, Duff was not the first woman, but she was one of the first Irish-American women. Now, what we found is that in the West, where the population is very different, ethnicity of this sort, you know, Irish-American, German-American, didn't seem to have any influence. So it didn't matter. You know, it's a different kind of society. But in Boston, where those powers are shifting between, you know, an upcoming Irish population, and in New York, which also had a large Irish population, you know, there were powers that didn't want the Irish to take over. All right, so here is a little bit, here's the front page of the actual website. This isn't the live version of it, it's a picture, but this is what it looks like. And you can see, if you can see along the top there, the sort of the reddish bar, this is where you can choose to search by state, by party, by woman's name. So, as I said, we're almost up to 3,400 different women. They ran under 20 different political parties. Women were campaigned in over 43 states and territories, and they ran for over 60 different offices. Okay. And then there's a little search button at the very end where you can combine some of these factors together. The URL is very easy. It's herhatwasintheRing.org. Okay, just one word, easy to remember. All right. There's also not only information about each of the women, but we've got these pages telling you about political parties and who ran what, where, and who supported what. More information about women by state and territory. We'll see a little bit later that most women ran in the Midwest and the West, though not entirely. Very few women in the South, but there were some. This is the search page, so you can choose and you can see a few of the different offices. I'll read some of them for you if I can see them myself. We've got judge, different judges, police judge. There was one woman who ran for sheriff. As we've seen, this woman who ran for the federal offices of senator, state offices of senator, House of Representative, governor, secretary of state. Various offices, but they're about 60. This one recmaster, and I'm not quite sure what that is, but recmaster. But a woman ran for it. Okay. All right, this is just another, a combination of more of the offices and so on. And then you can see this is actually the result of a search, and then this information could then be sorted by date. So you could get your search, all those Republican county treasurers in Kansas, and then you could find out what the earliest one is that we found. I will have to, you know, do repeat this, is that we found so far. There may be more coming later. So where do we find all this information? This project would not have been possible to do before the internet. And where we can, you know, when we started out, Jill and I were searching paper resources, books, biographies, directories, and then we started finding more and more and more women. We first thought it was 50, then we thought maybe about 200. Then we found an article published in Kansas in 1912 that said there were 750 women who'd run in Kansas alone before 1912. So we knew, okay, so now we're maybe up to 1,500 as it kept growing. But now a lot of these resources, like this item on the right here, which is a page from a blue book that the state of Utah, and Utah was one of the states that elected most of the women in this period. But this is actually a list of all their county officials. And you can see, I think you can see there, some of the ones are highlighted in yellow, and that is three women running for county recorder on the Republican, Democratic, and Progressive parties. Now, not all states publish these directories. They didn't publish them for every year. And many of them did not publish all the candidates who ran for office. They only published the winners. So sometimes we just don't know. But they also published, in this case, the vote count, so we do know who won. And there's another yellow little below that. There's a woman running for county treasurer, I think. Yes. And she's running against two men. So women ran against each other and ran against men. So these are the kind of resources that Google Books has put out. The Hathi Trust, the Internet Archives. These are companies that have published all of this material, scanned it and put it up and made it available. Let's see. So this is sort of a breakdown of some of the facts that we found so far. So 60% of women campaigned for educational offices. State superintendent of schools, county superintendent of schools, school boards. Okay, these were elected offices. In Pennsylvania, county superintendents of schools were chosen by school boards. So we did not include them. Because if you remember, we're only including women who were voted in or campaigned rather than by school boards. But most states it was a county, it was an elected position. In some states it was a partisan position, other states it was nonpartisan. It just depended on the state. 37, and I should say the reason it's so high in educational offices is that was the first area that women were allowed to run for office. Because of the shift in education in the United States in the 19th century, by the end of the century, the greatest number of high school students were women, young women. Teachers, in the beginning of the century, most teachers were men at all levels. By the middle of the century, that has shifted dramatically. And then a lot of teachers, especially on the lower level, were women. Women were getting more education. And one of the things that we found that's consistent for almost all of these women, the candidates, is that they were well educated for their time. Not all of them had gone to a college or university, but almost all of them had graduated high school. Many of them had become teachers and gone to teacher training colleges. Some of them had gone to university, and many of them had gone into the professions. There were doctors, there were PhDs, there were women, businesswomen, editors, and many other professions. But they were almost consistently well-educated. You can see 43% of the women were in the West. So that's where we found most of the candidates, which is fairly typical. Historiographically, we think of most the suffrage coming earlier in the West than anywhere else. Not completely accurate. The Pacific states were quite late in comparison. Wyoming was the first state to grant women's suffrage in 1869, full suffrage to women in Wyoming. Kansas was fairly soon after with partial suffrage, but they didn't grant full suffrage until 1912. And when I say grant, I should change that wording. Women fought long and hard for all of these suffrage rights, whether it just be for school boards, whether it be for presidential elections, which some women also had, for the right to vote on taxes. They were battles over and over and over again. Between 1850 and 1920, millions of women, millions, were participants in these women's rights movements. All right, so 17% of women who campaigned, especially in the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic, which is also very unusual. We thought that, you know, there were no women who came from it. It's a very conservative area in terms of women's rights. Most states were much later. Most states in this area didn't give women suffrage until 1920, like Pennsylvania. And again, though in some cases, like Massachusetts, New Hampshire, gave women school suffrage in the 1870s and 1880s. New York, 1880. Boston, Massachusetts, 1875 for Boston, the rest of the state in, I think, 1887. All right, there are only 3% in the South. Again, very conservative, much even more conservative than the Northeast. But there were some women, and we found some women who were in office that early. Party political, we only know the affiliation of women, their party, for about 40% of the races that we found. Partially is because the information just doesn't appear in a lot of these directories, or this was never given. And as I said, for some of these, particularly the educational offices, in some states they became nonpartisan. You didn't have to belong to a particular party. Though in some states you did, and there were big party machines that shifted back and forth through these, who got into these offices. So 56% of the main party candidates were either Republican or Democratic. And most of the ones that we do know about, the majority were Republican. And Democrats not far behind. And 44% of them were third party candidates. Socialist, prohibition, progressive, populist were the biggest, there were a few others. Very few of them got elected just as socialists or prohibitionists, but if they managed to get endorsement from one of the main parties, they were much more likely to succeed. All right, so as we said before, the 60% of these women campaigned for educational offices. School boards and county superintendents were important community offices. They decided on the disposition of school tax money. The county superintendents decided on what educational requirements teachers should have and what new, you know, additional training teachers needed. They also had good salaries, and some of these women wanted a salary. By this point, that is by the last quarter of the 19th century, many states had passed Women's Property Right Act, so that it was shifting from women who could own property in their own names. So if they earned a salary and they were married, in some states they could actually keep that money. And what we found, I think, mentioned before, is about half of the women were married and about half were single. There were a few widows and some divorced women, even surprisingly, they got elected, but there were some. Okay, so we already talked about the political parties and whether or not it was successful. And, you know, somebody has said that, you know, all politics is local, and indeed this seems to be true even with these women too. Different places, different standards, you know, which party was in power when and where, you know, who, which party they may have affiliated themselves with. There were shifts, of course, in political parties over time, too. So some place that seemed like a Republican stronghold, a decade later might have been a Democratic stronghold. There might have been challenges from a third party, particularly the Prohibitionists and the Progressives. Okay, skip from there. All right, so we talked about some of these geographical shifts. One of the things that we're also starting to include in our database, though it's not yet possible to see it in the public site, is we're giving each woman her geographical location. So eventually we'll be able to map them out and you'll be able to search. I mean, you can now search by state, but you can't search by region, for example. And that eventually, we're assigning regions to all of these candidates as well. So you'll be able to see all the women that ran in the Midwest, for example, all the women that ran in the Northeast. This is a very general graph to show you what happened through this period. You can see there's a very definite shift upward between how many women were elected in the middle of the 19th century up through towards the 1920. Okay. There's a little bit of a leveling out in the 1890s. I don't know why, but there was. And then you see this upward swing again, a very steep upward swing after the turn of the century. But this only tells us a certain amount. It just tells us very generally. It doesn't tell us where, this particular graph. It doesn't tell us which offices. It doesn't tell us any information about the women themselves, just this very general trend, which was to be expected, I think. So I just want to give you a little bit of another insight into the difficulties of this project. So you can't really see it, I don't think you can see, but there are numbers and all these little dots. And it's just by state, the number of women we've found so far. So this is kind of a map of different numbers of women. Okay. They tended to be from the middle of the country to the west. All right, so I wanted to do a comparison between Western state and Massachusetts, because it seems like there were more women elected in Massachusetts than in the West, which would be, we wouldn't believe that to be true. It seems to be, it would have been the opposite. But what we don't, what this doesn't map, this kind of map doesn't tell us, is that in Massachusetts, all of those positions were educational ones. So as we already discussed, women were allowed to run for educational offices starting in the 1870s and 1880s in Massachusetts, but that was it. And until 1920, there were no other either suffrage or educational rights for women in Massachusetts. But even though there were fewer numbers of women in this West, I think this is supposed to be Washington, they were a much broader range of offices. So, you know, it's quantity versus sort of variety of ways that women could actually be elected and their rights were available. Washington was a very interesting case because women got the right to vote in Washington in the 1880s. And then there was a court challenge and the law was declared unconstitutional. And they didn't get the vote back until 1912. So they had it, it was taken away. Utah, very similar. Utah is an unusual case because of the, as a territory, Utah gave women the right to vote. But when they tried to become a state in the 1880s, Congress had several requirements for Utah. One was to get rid of polygamy, and the other was to take voting rights away from women. And Utah did both. And once it became a state, polygamy supposedly remained illegal, but women got the right to vote back in, I think, 1895. And immediately, several women were elected to the state house. And then the year later, the first woman state senator was elected. She was a plural wife, meaning that her husband had several wives. She was a doctor, Dr. Martha Cannon, and she ran against her own husband. All right, so you can see what I've just said here about Massachusetts and Washington, where it looks like there's a lot of women who are elected to office, but again, they were only within that educational sphere, and just really to school boards and county superintendents. And then this gives you kind of another look at that as well. Okay, just ways of looking at this data. So we're not only interested in the project in trying to name all these women, we're also interested in trying to aggregate the data and try to make some conclusions about what happened in this period in terms of women's citizenship rights and also being elected. What does it mean? How do we interpret it? You know, it's we can say some of these generalizations, but in actuality, there are significant differences, and we need to we can't just say, oh, it was great, women did get elected to office. It, you know, more and more women got elected to office. That's fine, but we also need to know more about this because it is significant when we try to discuss what this actually means. Okay, that's again some of what I've just been saying about the differences there between them. So, this is the Her Hat Was in the Ring project that only has a website and database and information. We also have a Facebook page. Every day there's a new woman that comes up. We also put up some of these materials and talk about them. This is something else that happened just recently, which I thought you might find interesting, which was a couple of Trump supporters who have called for the repeal of the 19th Amendment. Okay. Awesome. Which would mean that taking away, I think it could be done before the election. But because women are such a factor in this election, that he took away women's right to vote. I haven't seen a call for the repeal of the 15th Amendment yet, but maybe that's up there too, and I haven't seen it. And this is just a page from that site that is hashtag repeal the 19th.
And that's from Trump himself, or just?
I think it was from a supporter. I don't think he did that, no. But, you know, I mean, these things kind of grow, they mushroom. I mean, anybody can put anything up, and I think when I read about this, there was some more information on the site. It's very hard to trace tweets to see where they started. So we don't know who actually started this. But I thought you might find it interesting as a history forum. All right, so a group of eight women who have run for president, this is just the end here. Margaret Chase Smith here, a Republican senator from Maine. I don't think she knew about Olive Rose, however. But she was a very powerful senator in the 1950s, and in 1964 she became the first woman to run for president or primary from a major party, a Republican. Next to her is Pat Schroeder in Congress from Colorado, who also ran for president, Democrat. Next to her is Sonia Johnson from Utah, but I don't think that she knew about the history of her state and its large numbers of women who had been elected to office, a wide variety of offices. She was ran on the Citizens Party, and I think she had left the Church of Latter-day Saints by then. and she was supporter of the ERA, too. Last woman on the end there is Jill Stein. who's currently running for president, but has run in previous elections as well. And she's running for president on the Green Party. I think maybe in 2008, I think it was, or was it 12, I'm not sure. She ran for president, and her running mate was Sherry Honkola, who's the head of the Philadelphia Kensington Welfare Rights Union. But she's got a different running mate this time. I did see his name, but anyway. Shirley Chisholm, first African-American woman in Congress, ran for president on the Democratic Party primary, 72, 68, I can never remember. She did not win, but got a biography of her here. Her motto was unbought and unbossed. And she was the first African-American to run for president. Elizabeth Dole, Republican, who ran for president. Carol Mosley Braun, Democrat, had been in the Senate, running for president. And now we have Hillary Clinton, obviously, the first major party candidate, not just running in the primary. The Democrats also had run Geraldine Ferraro, okay, in 1984, for vice president. She was the first woman to run on a major party for vice president. And there's some other buttons here. There's a few others on the table for women who ran, other women who ran, and also, or were nominated. Sometimes they didn't actually run, so I did a button, you know, created a button to show their support for them, but some of them did actually run campaigns. Okay, I think we're done. All right. So I'm happy to talk to you, answer questions, and certainly yes, come up after and you can talk about this stuff. Yes.
Yes, I was just wondering, do you ever have any families that tell you about ancestors that have run for office?
I'm sorry.
Did you ever have any families that tell you about ancestors that have run for office?
Yes, indeed. Some of the resources that we've used on the internet have been on family websites. You know, people have put up genealogy and they've talked about it. And there are people who have donated the papers of their family members to libraries and archives, so we've seen that too. And we've had a few people contact us just through the website and the Facebook page who say, you know, tell us about whether it's their family members or others that they know about that we don't have on the website yet. So we're always happy to find out about people, and we still are working on this. It's just that we haven't had much funding. So this has all been done on our own time. And the other person I didn't mention, Dr. Kristen Wynn Becker, who's the founder of an IT company called History IT, which is preserving history, digitizing it. Her company's designed our website and the database system as well. So, but indeed, we have had people. We found them through family information as well.
How did the term suffrage come into being?
I'm sorry, Lee?
How did the term suffrage come into being?
I think that it's a very old term. It's not suffering, it's suffrage.
Suffrage,
yeah,
yes.
So I do you know?
I don't.
No. Somebody was asking me the other day, why do we use the word canvassing? You know, for people going out to find out about, how people are going to vote, or to ask them to please vote in a certain way. You know, that word, where did that come from? So I think that probably suffrage is probably part of a Latin word for voting, but I don't know for sure. Good question. Yes.
Yes, yesterday's New York Times had a long article on Victoria Woodhull.
Oh, yeah, so good.
Yes, she was quite a character.
Yes, she was.
And she ran for president even though she couldn't vote.
That's right.
Which
right. And Lockwood also. And Lockwood said, I cannot vote, but I can be voted for. Yes.
In the early years, right, would there have been an awareness of the commonality of women struggling for the right to vote in England, France. Do they see this as a common struggle?
Yes, yes. And there were international organizations, both just women's organizations and women's internet. There was an international suffrage alliance. So there were international organizations. And yes, women wrote to each other. Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton met in England. Neither one of them is English, they're both American, but they were both attending the World Anti-Slavery Convention in 1840 in London. And at that convention, American organizations, anti-slavery organizations, had nominated women delegates. And the group as a whole in London did not want to seat, voted not to seat those women delegates. So they had to sit on the side. And this just, you know, these women were like furious. Very nicely, William Lloyd Garrison, who was one of the radical abolitionists in the United States, went and sat with them, as did a few other men. But yes, yeah, so they were international. Yes.
I wondered it might, whether you have this data point or whether there would be any way to suss this out, whether these women who were running or being elected were the wives or sisters or daughters of male office holders. Because I was noticing that about the presidents, the three of those women were either married to or related to someone else who had
the
high office.
The women, the last one, yes.
That's often how women get put in.
Yes, and it seemed to be certainly how women got into high state offices after suffrage. Mm-hmm. You see some women who were the wives of senators, for example, who then took over their husbands. I think Margaret Chase Smith did, for example. But we find mostly in these other local offices, no. I mean, there are some, I see the same name on school boards sometimes, so some of those local groups, but not that often. They're very, very different. I mean, women are really becoming community activists, or at least participants, after the turn of the century, certainly by the last quarter of the 19th century. It becomes almost a duty, a womanly duty to participate in organizing the library, serving on the school board, volunteering for the women's club and social organizations. But some of these social organizations are also become very crucial to running a community when there's no sanitation paid for by the community. If a group of people organizes for garbage to be collected, that's an important community service.
Excuse me.
Yes. I was thinking about the school stuff, and that reflects a change in how women's authority about children happened over time. Was that an organized effort? Or in the same way that suffrage was?
I think that it was organized, but I don't think it was the same as suffrage. Mm-hmm. So in the 18-teens and 20s, women start to get more education. But they're starting to say, wait a minute, how can we be patriotic citizens of a republic when we don't have citizenship rights that men have? And so the role that kind of culturally became popular for women was to become educators of citizens, and also to train women to be educators of citizens. So that was the role that the women could play in this new republic, rather than being actors on a governmental level. So it became a cultural prerogative,
Did you know how much formal education Harriet Beecher Stowe had?
Yeah. Well, her sister Catherine, her older sister Catherine, was a huge proponent of educating women. Now, she didn't believe in women's rights. She believed that women had a separate sphere. But she did think that women should be teachers and educators of the nation. So, but that was opening up a huge field for women. Now, Harriet, as you know, became well known across the US and Europe, sold huge numbers of books with the publication of Uncle Tom's Cabin. She was kind of between her sister and the suffrage movement. She was never really a proponent of suffrage. I think she did believe that women had a role in society. She became very involved in sexual politics, and actually Victoria Woodhull in the 1870s and 1880s for these reasons. So in 1871, 72, Catherine and Harriet's brother, Henry Ward Beecher, the most well-known minister of his day, the Billy Graham of his, the Jerry Falwell of his generation. He was the pastor of a big church, very well-to-do church in Brooklyn, New York, was accused by Victoria Woodhull of having an affair with the wife of one of his parishioners. And it became this huge scandal. Everybody took sides. And eventually, even though he actually was having the affair, I mean, he denied it all, he really was, Woodhull was right. And she was demanding that this is one of those instances where men and women should be held to the same standards. You know, we should require that Henry Ward Beecher be held up to these moral standards. But he was exonerated by a board. It wasn't a legal matter, but the board of his church found him to be not guilty. And of course, Woodhull then became this kind of siren, this evil woman who would accuse this very well-to-do minister. About 10 years later, and then Harriet supported Henry, but about 10 years later, Harriet, in one of her trips to England, had met with Lady Byron, Lord Byron's wife. And we know that Byron, now we know, that Byron had had affairs with all these different women. He'd actually had an affair with his half-sister, he had a child with her, but none of this was really public knowledge. Harriet wrote an article for, and his wife, Lady Byron, had been kind of ostracized by society and had been sort of made into this very, you know, she wasn't really up to Lord Byron, she was just trying to drag him down, he was this great poet. Harriet Beecher Stowe wrote this article for the Atlantic Monthly called Lady Byron Vindicated, and opened up this whole kettle of fish. Now, I don't know why, she thought that the men and women should be held to the same moral standards, that men should have to react to the same standards that women were held to. But it's very interesting. And Harriet actually wrote introductions to books that were against polygamy in Utah, saying how these were, you know, sexually exploiting women. So there's something that happens with Harriet. Don't know quite what, I just don't know. But she becomes kind of this, you know, involved in these sort of sexual politics.
Do you know how much formal education she had?
I think she had been educated at home, and then she went, Catherine was quite a bit older, and I think that she went to one of Harriet's schools for young women, too. So, but that was the extent of her education.
Ma'am, I got in late and I didn't hear you recently.
I'm
what
sorry?
Where did some of the, what sort of inspirations did these early suffragettes draw from, historically or principled, or where did this energy come from?
The Declaration of Independence and the Enlightenment and Thomas Paine and Mary Wollstonecraft, Vindication of the Rights of Woman, based on Tom Paine's Vindication of the Rights of Man. So they basically are natural rights arguments. That is, if all men are equal, that is, all human beings are equal, why aren't we? And so the idea that the Republic promises equal rights to everyone, they believe that it should extend to women. Now that changes over the 19th century. There are other arguments that come in, arguments that, well, mothers should have rights because they're raising the next generation of citizens. So, and mothers have special, ideas about how children should be raised, and children are the future, and we need to form them in proper ways. So if you're going to be responsible for educating future citizens, you need to be educated yourself. You need to have access to laws, because, you know, if your husband or their father is going to drink everything away, women have to have economic resources, they have to have the rights of guardianship, and so on.
Did they at all look to past historical figures like Queen Elizabeth of England?
In some cases, yes. There were quite a number of books in the 19th century that came out with some of the, as you say, some of the well-known figures. Queen Victoria, of course, even though she was very much of a domestic figure in some ways as well. But she was a queen, Queen Elizabeth. There were several books just about with American women who actually had been teachers, who had been religious leaders, even if they weren't ordained ministers, and so on. Businesswomen and so, you know, Molly Pitcher, Betsy Ross, and all of those figures as well. There were quite a number of books published about female poets and female writers. So women certainly could earn a living by their pen in this time, but quite often they were never paid as much as men, and you see that over and over and over again. That one of the arguments sometimes for hiring women teachers is it would save the school district money, because women teachers just didn't earn as much as men, even if they were at the same level. It was quite expected. There was definitely no equal pay for equal work, even though it was there in the Declaration of Sentiments in 1848. It was not reality, and some would argue it still isn't reality. Yes?
The British suffragette movement was much more violent than the American. Why?
The British movement is actually much more diverse than we are told about now. So I don't know if you've seen the movie Suffragettes, which is about the militant suffragists led by the Women's Social and Political Union. But there are actually many other organizations in Great Britain that did not use militant suffrage techniques as well. I don't know completely the answer to your question. There's certainly people who tried what we might think of as direct action. You know, there were women who tried to vote in the United States. They were not violent, but they would go up to a Woodhull was one, Susan B. Anthony was one, a woman named Valerie Miner in Missouri, because it became a Supreme Court case. Trying to vote, but those were not militant actions. I think that it was just this seemed, I guess, I think that in Great Britain it seemed to that militant faction that their tactics, that was the only way they could make government officials take notice.
Because they were really violent.
They were quite violent, yes. Mm. Against property, not against people, but against property. The British allowed women to vote for municipal councils, 1889, all British women. There was a woman elected to the London County Council in 1889, daughter of a very radical member of Parliament, Richard Cobden, and she was Jane Cobden. But women had the right to be elected to county councils in Great Britain in 1907. But that vote, that national vote for Parliament, didn't come till 1919. For women over the age of 28, over the age of 30, and then all women in 1928.
Yeah, it was after the American.
It was after, for all of women, yes. And of course, there are still countries that just granted women, Saudi Arabia just granted women electoral rights and suffrage rights.
Partial though, right?
I'm sorry?
I think they're partial rights.
Yeah. And Switzerland, 1970.
Yeah.
You know, France after the Second World War, 1948. I mean, it's very different all over. Parts of Australia, women had voting rights much earlier. New Zealand was very early. Iceland was very early. There, you know, you can look this up online. There are nice charts of when women got voting rights in different parts of the world.
Ma'am, mentioned that I came in late, so I missed most of your presentation.
I'm sorry, can you hear me?
I came in late, so I missed most of your presentation.
Okay.
What did you say about Eleanor Roosevelt, and were any other first ladies active besides Eleanor Roosevelt politically active?
Who were that active? I think that she was probably the first who was that active. I think that Woodrow Wilson's wife was actually quite active also. He suffered a stroke in his second term.
I know about that.
And that she actually did a lot of the behind the scenes governing. But I think that Eleanor was really the first lady who was so active, so public a figure, so much of her own part of a presidential administration.
Which Mrs. Wilson was that?
I'm sorry, thank
which you. Mrs. Wilson are you talking about?
Woodrow Wilson.
If he had more than one wife.
Edith.
And then of course they said that she was de facto president.
Right. So, anyone else? Anyway, as I say, please come up and have a look at and I know there's some refreshments over there too, but I'm happy to tell you about any of the materials here. Some of them actually are original materials, campaign materials. We have a letter from the first woman mayor, 1887, Kansas, and a few other ballots and buttons and so on.
Well, I think we should thank Wendy for coming.